Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Soma Patnaik from Manav Rachna International University. Today, we are going to discuss about the module Ion Exchange Chromatography, which includes instrumentation, method development, validation, quantification, and troubleshooting from paper chromatographic techniques. So students, let us see what we are going to learn in this module. The students will learn the different components of an ion exchange chromatograph and understand the basic functioning and role of each component involved in the instrument. Second, the students will understand how to develop a method for carrying out purification or separation of an analyte in ion exchange chromatography. Third, the students will be able to understand what goes into validating the method that has been developed for ion exchange chromatography. Next, the students will now be able to understand the quantification procedure needed in ion exchange chromatographic technique. And the students will also be able to understand the problems which are faced during the ion exchange chromatography and how to troubleshoot these problems. The basic components of an ion exchange chromatograph is shown in the picture. Now, let me tell you how the ion exchange chromatograph is operated. The mobile phase, which comprises of a buffer or a solvent system, is introduced into this chromatographic system by the high pressure pump. Now, the pump pushes the mobile phase into the next component by the exit non-return valve. The sample is now injected through the injector port, which goes to the charged ion exchange column. That is, it could be an ionic resin or a cationic resin, depending on the type of ion exchanger instrument opted for along with the mobile phase. Here, the ion exchange phenomena occurs on the column, which leads to the separation of molecules. Now, the suppressor plays an important role. It reduces the conductivity of the eluent and increases the conductivity of the analyte so as to facilitate the movement of analytes to conductivity detector. Now, the complete setup of ion exchange chromatograph is managed by a computer-aided software which acquires and processes the data which is obtained during the complete chromatographic procedure. Now let us talk about the different components used in ion exchange chromatography. To begin with, the very first step is the selection of a mobile phase. In ion exchange chromatography, there can be two solvents or more, which is blended according to the need to form the mobile phase reservoirs. Usually, most of the purification or separation in ion exchange chromatography technique uses 2 to 3 mobile phases. These mobile phases are kept in glass bottles or in plastic bottles, which are made up of polyether ketone, popularly known as PEEK. PEEK is used as it is chemically inert to most of the organic solvents. Now, this is necessary as the mobile phases contain charged ions which may damage normal plastic bottles. Prior using the mobile phase reservoir for ion exchange chromatography, degassing of solvents is very important. If it is not done, it may result in sharp spikes in the chromatogram. For this, the solvents are vacuum treated for approximately 5 minutes, followed by helium purging. Then these solvents are kept under helium atmosphere. Now, after discussing about the mobile phase reservoir, let me tell you students about the role of high pressure pump that is used in ion exchange chromatograph. The high pressure pump delivers the mobile phase into the ion exchange chromatograph at a constant flow rate. Understand this, students. The mobile phase reservoirs are connected to a solvent selection valve and a selection programmer. Now, during the chromatographic procedure, we select a program according to our need, to which the solvents from the mobile phase reservoirs are now selected and pushed to the sampling device, from where it goes to the ion exchange column. The pumps used in ion exchange chromatography can be either single piston or dual piston pumps. The piston and cylinder used in the pump are again made from inert material because, as I have already told you, the solvent or the mobile phase used in ion exchange chromatograph contains ions which can be corrosive and may damage the coating if not made up of inert material. Now, in this figure, it shows the various parts of pump which is used in ion exchange chromatography. So, let's discuss the functioning of the pump. The cylinder of the pump is filled with the solvent or the mobile phase reservoir from the inlet non-return valve. The cam drives the piston into the cylinder, thereby pushing the solvent to the exit non-return valve. The mobile phase, when pushed from exit non-return valve, enters the ion exchange column. The piston then comes back to its original state by the return spring. During this whole process, while the piston returns back to its original position, the cylinder is again filled with the mobile phase through the inlet non-return valve, and the whole process of pumping keeps repeating in the same manner. Now, after getting to know about pumping, the mobile phase enters the injector port where it combines with the mobile phase and is then flushed into the ion exchange column. The sample is injected through a needle into the valve where it goes to the sample loop. Now, this valve is known as the injector port. The port is then rotated in a direction where the mobile phase combines with the sample and it flushes the sample into the column. The valves are made from inert materials in ion exchange chromatograph. In this figure, it explains the functioning of an injector port of ion exchange chromatograph. When the port is in position A, the sample is injected, and when the sample needs to be pushed into the column system, the valve is rotated to position B, where the mobile phase flushes the sample into the column. So, now the liquid system comprises of mobile phase and sample, which moves over the charged column of the ion exchange chromatographic system. Column in ion exchange chromatography. Now, let's come to the very important component of ion exchange chromatographic technique, which is the column. The basis of separation of compounds in ion exchange chromatography is the net surface charge. If the stationary phase, that is, here it is the resin or the matrix of the column, is positively charged, then the negatively charged ions will bind to it and vice versa. The efficient separation of compounds depends on some very important parameters such as pH, buffers, salts, detergents, organic solvents, and temperature. So, a lot of basic phenomena goes on when the sample along with the mobile phase passes through the column. Now, there are two types of columns that are used in ion exchange chromatography. One is the guard column and the other separating column. Now, what is a guard column? Guard column is placed anterior to the separating column where actual separation or the purification of the compound or the mixture takes place. The role of the guard column, as the name itself implies, is to protect or guard the separating column so that the longevity of the separating column is prolonged. Guard column filters particles that can cause clogging in the separating column, which may affect the sensitivity of the ion exchange chromatograph. If the particles are not properly filtered by the guard column, then it may give rise to false peaks or a decreased resolution in the chromatogram. Now, after the sample goes through the guard column, it reaches the separating column where ion exchange occurs depending on the surface charge of the resin or the matrix and the sample ions. If the resin is positively charged, then it is known as anion exchanger, and if negatively charged, then it is called cation exchanger. Now, the column is either made up of stainless steel, titanium, glass, or polyether ether ketone, popularly known as PEEK, which is an inert plastic. One should always go for columns which are made up of inert materials for efficient ion exchange chromatographic procedure. The column in ion exchange chromatography is packed with resins or matrix which are coated with charged groups depending on the type of separation required. Now, there are different types of charged groups that are used for coating onto the resin. The commonly used charged groups for stationary phase are aminoethyl, diethyl aminoethyl, which is commonly known as DEAE, trimethyl aminoethyl, that is TAM, triethyl aminomethyl, known as TEAE, diethyl 2-hydroxypropylamine ethyl, carboxymethyl, sulfonic groups, sulfomethyl groups, and sulfopropyl group. Amongst these, the very commonly used anion exchangers are diethyl aminoethyl, that is DEAE, and diethyl 2-hydroxypropylamine ethyl, that is QAE. Carboxymethyl, commonly known as CM, sulfopropyl, that is SP, and sulfonic functional, that is S, are the commonly used cation exchange chromatograph. Now let us move to the next important component used in ion exchange chromatography, which is the suppressor. Now, what is a suppressor? Suppressor is a very important instrument which is used in getting noise-free and high-resolution peaks of the analytes in ion exchange chromatography. The role of suppressor is to reduce the background conductivity of the chemicals that are used to elute samples from the ion exchange column so that the accurate conductivity measurement of the sample ions are obtained. These suppressors are membrane-based devices which convert the ionic eluent to water in order to improve the sensitivity. As discussed earlier, we can now describe the role of suppressor for first decreasing or reducing the background conductivity of the eluent, second, minimizing the baseline noise, third, transforming the analytes to free ions with protons as counter ions, thereby improving the conductivity signal. Next, optimizing the signal to noise ratio. And last but not the least, increasing the detection sensitivity of the ion exchange chromatograph. So, when the analyte passes through the column and suppressor, how does it get detected? For this, detectors are used in ion exchange chromatography. Now, these detectors are connected to a digital display board such as computer, where the resolution of peaks can be observed. An ideal detector for ion exchange chromatography should have the following properties. First, low drift and noise level. Second, this is very important for analysis of compounds which are present in minute or trace quantities. It should have a very high sensitivity. The detector should have a very fast response. There should be low dead volume so that there is minimal peak broadening. A proper cell design is very important so that there is no remixing of the separated bands. It should not affect or destroy the separated or purified compound. It should be insensitive to changes in flow rate, type of the solvent, and temperature fluctuations. And also, it should be very simple to operate and should be highly reliable so that reproducible results are obtained. There are different types of detectors that are used in ion exchange chromatography. The different types of detectors used are: first, electrical conductivity detector; second, amperometric detector; and third is the mass spectrometric detector. Now, there are three types of detectors that are usually used in ion exchange chromatography. First is the electrical conductivity detector. Now, let us talk about this detector. The sensor of this conductivity detector consists of only two electrodes, which are situated in a suitable flow cell. The sensor consists of two electrodes which are arranged in a Wheatstone bridge. Now, when the ions move into the sensor cell, the electrical impedance between the electrodes changes and the out of balance signal from the Wheatstone bridge is now fed to a suitable electronic circuit. In this detector, the out of balance signal is not directly linearly related to the ion concentration in the cell. The electronic circuit therefore modifies the response of the detector to provide an output that is linearly related to the ion concentration. The second type of detector which is used is amperometric detector. Now, this detector is usually used in pharmaceutical industries. It is a very and highly sensitive detector. It is used to detect compounds that can be easily reduced or oxidized. Now, one of the most important applications of this detector lies in the analysis of sugars by anion chromatography, where pulsed amperometric detection, which is PAD, is employed. The third detector that is used in the ion exchange chromatography is the mass spectrometric detector. In this detector, mass to charge ratio, which is defined as M divided by Z, is taken into consideration for specific compound identity, that is the ID determination. Now, the M by Z value of a compound is unique for that compound, hence is considered its identity. The detector usually contains low volume cell through which the mobile phase passes carrying the sample components. Now, after learning about different components of ion exchange chromatograph instrument, let's understand how a method is developed and validated for carrying out the analysis technique in ion exchange chromatograph. In-depth characterization of charge heterogeneity of any biomolecule requires robust and efficient ion exchange chromatographic methods. Method development involves a thorough evaluation of all possible experimental parameters such as buffer or the ionic strength, its pH, salt gradient, flow rate, and the column temperature. Systematic evaluation of individual experimental parameters on the separation performance often requires a time-consuming trial and error processes that involves preparing and testing the buffers of varying compositions. Now, this process involves preparing multiple buffers at a specific pH and ionic strength, followed by testing of each buffer system until an adequate separation is achieved. After knowing the details of the various components used in ion exchange chromatography, we have to develop a method suitable for analysis of compounds using ion exchange chromatography. Now, there are some very important or key points that need to be kept in mind when we develop a method for ion exchange chromatography. These are: first, retention of a compound is optimized by the adjustment of ionic strength of the mobile phase. Second, the selectivity is optimized with the pH. Third, changing the buffer and the counter ions may improve the selectivity criteria. Fourth, if there is any change in the temperature, then there may be a need to modify the developed method. Now, after developing the method protocol for ion exchange chromatography, it is very important to carry out the validation. Now here, what does the validation mean? Validation means to check if the method developed is valid or accurate for carrying out the analysis. So, validation is very important part of chromatographic procedure, which shows that the method developed, when operated within a set of parameters, can consistently produce the specific product. The validation is cumbersome and again time-consuming process, as it includes validation of equipment, software, utilities, equipment cleaning, and analytical methods. An important part of validation is developing and writing validation protocols. These validation studies should be prepared well in advance. Validating the removal of impurities elements, the tedious task of measuring these impurities in each batch prior to release. Parameters should also be validated as it affects the processes and the products obtained. The parameters that are studied are the load and the pH and the conductivity of the buffers. Next, reuse validation method helps in determining the number of times a column may be used for the chromatographic procedure. Now, after the method development and the validation procedure, it is very important to know how to go about quantifying the analytes that have undergone the separation procedure in ion exchange chromatography. Now, in the ion exchange chromatogram, each peak represents a separate ion from the sample solution. The concentration of ions moving through the column at a particular time is represented by the height and the breadth of the peaks and can be correlated to the concentration of a particular ion or the species present in the sample solution. Anions and cations can be independently efficiently separated using ion exchange chromatography. Now, the detection limits of 0.05 to 0.58 ppm for the anions and 0.05 to 0.38 parts per million for the cations have been reported in ion exchange chromatographic techniques. Ion concentrations can be calculated using the area under the each peak, where a larger area correlates with a higher concentration of a particular ion species. Now, most ion chromatographic machines provide a software that calculates this particular area, which users can convert to parts per million, that is ppm, or other quantity using calibration standard solutions. Now that we know the importance of method development, validation, and quantification, it is very important and crucial to know what are the problems one might face during the ion exchange chromatography and how to go about solving them. Now, one very important problem that may arise is that the desired separation is not achieved. Now, what does that mean? That means the target proteins, although are very well resolved by the gradient elution, as can be seen in the figure. However, only certain peaks are of interest in this well-resolved gradient elution separation. Then it can be advantageous to go for a step solution so that we can save on time and buffer. Now, what if our sample elutes before the salt gradient begins? So, in such a scenario, we should reduce the ionic strength of the sample by desalting or diluting it with the starting buffer. For an anion exchanger, we should increase the buffer pH. And for a cation exchanger, we should decrease the buffer pH. Now, if the proteins still do not bind at any pH, then we should look for any contamination in the column, which may be due to the presence of a detergent. Now, what if the sample elutes during the high salt wash? Now, what does this imply? This implies that the proteins are binding very strongly to the column. So, in such a scenario, one should ensure that the buffers are present in the correct containers. Again, if we are using an anion exchanger, one should go for decreasing the buffer pH. And if we are using a cation exchanger, then one should increase the buffer pH. Another problem that may arise is if our protein or proteins of interest are eluting late in the gradient. So, what do we do now? Now, this property shows that the proteins are very tightly bound to the column. Again, we should go for increasing the ionic strength of the gradient. Here again, for an anion exchanger, we should decrease the buffer pH, and for a cation exchanger, increase the buffer pH. Now, in certain cases, proteins of interest may elute too early in the gradient. So, what does this mean? Now, this means that our proteins of interest are not binding strongly. We should now, in such a scenario, check the ionic strength of the gradient. Now, we should go for again alteration of the pH. As discussed earlier, for an anion exchanger, we should increase the buffer pH, and for a cation exchanger, we should decrease the buffer pH. What if there is a reduced or no flow through the column? Now, there may be many reasons to this. One of the common reason may be that the outlet is closed or the pumps might not be working. So, prior to the start of the experiment, one should check if the outlet is closed or open and if the pumps have any leakage or not. The second probable reason could be there could be a blocked filter, adapter or tubing. So, one should remove and clean or replace, if possible, these adapters, filters or tubing. One very important point to look into is that one should always filter the samples before they are used. The third reason could be there is the protein precipitation in the column. Now, what do we do? We should now modify the buffer, pH and or salt conditions during the run so that the stability is maintained. One should always follow proper cleaning procedures. Another reason could be the microbial growth into the column. For this, column needs to be stored in the presence of 20% ethanol so that microbial growth is prevented when the columns are not in use. And again, the buffers which are to be used should always be filtered prior their use. Now, another problem that could arise could be the peak of interest, that is the peak of the analyte that we need, is very poorly resolved from other major peaks. So, what could be the probable reasons for this? One, the sample that we have applied to the system, it may not be applied correctly. So, we need to apply the sample correctly. Second, the use of incorrect buffer pH and or ionic strength. So now we should again check for the pH and ionic strength of the buffer so as to ensure that column was re-equilibrated after previous runs. We should check the conditions if required, and if needed, new solutions should be prepared. Another probable reason could be that the sample applied to the column is too viscous. In that scenario, one should dilute the sample with buffer. One should always maintain the protein concentration below 50 milligrams per ml. The fourth point could be that the column is poorly packed. So now, we should check the column efficiency, and if it is needed, one should repack the column. It is always good to use pre-packed columns. The other reason could be that the column is overloaded. So, we should decrease the sample load in such a scenario. What if we get a leading or very rounded peaks in chromatogram? That means the peaks are not very sharp. Now, the probable reasons for such a problem could be that again the column may be overloaded or the column may be contaminated. As I have told you earlier, the samples should be diluted and the column should always be kept at minus 20 degrees centigrade when not in use. Now, the other problem that could arise could be that the peaks are tailing, that is, they have a longer tail. Now, the probable reason for such a problem could be incorrect start buffer conditions or sample may not be binding to the column. Now, to avoid this, adjust pH and check salt concentrations in the start buffer. Another reason could be that the column packing is too loose. For this, one should check the column efficiency and repack using a higher flow rate. It is always advisable to go for pre-packed columns. The another reason could be sample is too viscous. Again, as I have told you earlier, dilute the sample before they are loaded into the system. What if the peaks have a leading edge? Now, in this case, the probable reason could be that the column packing may be compressed. One should check for column efficiency and one should repack using a lower flow rate. Again, it is advisable to go for pre-packed columns in ion exchange chromatography. Another problem that we could face could be the low recovery of activity but normal recovery of protein. Now, what does that mean? That means we obtain a normal amount of protein but then the protein obtained has a decreased activity. This could be because the protein might be unstable or inactive in the buffer that we have used for the mobile phase. Another problem that could arise in the chromatography could be that we get spikes in chromatogram. Now, there is an air bubble which could be trapped in the UV monitor flow cell. So, as I've already told you, it is very important to degas the buffers that are used. Now, what if the UV baseline rises with the gradient? Now, there could be few reasons to this. First, there could be micelle formation as the salt concentration changes. For this problem, one should work below or above the critical micelle concentration of any detergents that are being used or change the gradient so that the increase in UV absorption does not occur while the samples are eluting. The second reason could be the buffer impurities. It is always important to use high quality reagents and always filter your buffers prior to their use. So students, it's time to summarize what we have learnt in this module. We now know different components of an ion exchange chromatograph. Next, we also know that the choice of mobile reservoir is crucial in developing a method for ion exchange chromatography. We now know that the mobile reservoirs should be kept in bottles which are made up of either glass or inert material such as PEEK, which is an inert plastic. Next, there are different types of pumps that are used in the ion exchange chromatograph. We have learned that it could be either a single or a dual piston driven pump. We now know that the injector port is made up of inert material so that there is no wear and tear due to the sample injection. We also know that the column should be properly and neatly packed, and that the choice of packing material has to be made depending on the type of ions that are required to be separated. We now have studied the role of guard column. So, guard column should be used along with the separating column so that the longevity of the separating column is maintained. We also have understood the role of suppressor. Suppressor plays a very important role in reducing the background noise to signal ratios. It also decreases the conductivity of the eluent. We have studied the different types of detectors that are used in ion exchange chromatography. These are electrical conductivity, amperometric, and mass spectrometric detectors. We now know that the electrical conductivity detector is the most commonly used detector, whereas amperometric detector is very highly sensitive and is usually used in pharmaceutical industries. We now have understood that the mass spectrometric detector is characteristic of a compound and is used for its identity determination. We have studied how important is the method development in ion exchange chromatography. It involves a thorough evaluation of all the possible experimental parameters such as buffer, ionic strength, its pH, salt, gradient, flow rate, and the column temperature. Again, we have understood the importance of validation. It is very important because it shows that the method that we have developed for carrying out the analysis, when operated within a set of parameters, can consistently produce the specific product. Now, for the quantification, the concentration of ions moving through the column at a particular time is represented by the height and the breadth of the peaks and can be correlated to the concentration of a particular species in the sample solution. We have also learned that there can be many problems during the ion exchange chromatographic procedure. So, it is important to prepare always fresh buffers and use them at their prepared pH. It is very important to maintain the column and check for any contamination prior to use. One should always use a diluted sample for analysis. It is advisable to go for pre-packed columns. Columns should be tightly packed and the sample should not be overloaded. The solvents that are used for mobile phase should be degassed and purged with helium prior to the use for efficient ion exchange chromatographic procedure. Thank you.